Hi, we're here at the Hoboken Historical Museum. This show is pre-recorded, and I imagine you're watching it either on Facebook, YouTube, or Twitter. We are happy that you are checking out this archive show. Previous interview shows on Hoboken Talks have included guests Steve Zane, Victoria Maiano, Dave Carney, Anthony Dell'Aquila, and many, many more. We must have done at least 35 programs to date. Generally, they are live 7 o'clock on Thursday night, but due to a few circumstances, we are pre-recording the show and the show goes on. Again, my name is Bob Foster, director at the Hoboken Museum. Our hosts do change, but you're lucky to have me tonight. And I'm so happy to have our guests on the show. And this sitting to my left is Jim Link. I'm not sure if that's your right or my left or whatever, but Jim, thanks so much for being here.
Well, thank you. I'm happy to be here.
Okay. I guess to start it off, can you talk a little bit about the background? You provided some great Hoboken images. And what's this one all about?
Let's see. I'm behind you, and that's fine. But this was
should I move? Oh, there you are.
Yeah, there I am.
Is that it?
Yeah, and I have my little shopping cart full of cleaning supplies.
Okay.
For many years, from around the mid-90s to the early 2000s, I was Jiffy Jim. And I went to people's houses and just cleaned. And if you need somebody in a hurry, Jiffy Jim was there.
Okay.
And did that for about 6 years. Met a lot of people from Hoboken, new and old residents, former residents, people come back. And it was a lot of fun.
And the storefront you're in front of?
In front of Richard Altamari's laundromat. And there was always that nice older gentleman there. And I had a friend in town that week, and it was a day I had to work. So I set her free into Hoboken. Her fiance lived in Hoboken, so she was happy to run around. And I was off to work somewhere to clean somebody's apartment.
So I see you as a real cheerleader for Hoboken. And
yeah.
Why? I mean, a lot of time you're born and raised here.
Yes.
So that gives you good creds.
Yes.
But I do meet a lot of Hoboken folks who are not as positive about Hoboken as you are. Why are you so jazzed on Hoboken?
Well, I think both me and my mom were pretty jazzed about Hoboken because you can get everything you need here. And we both like to meet people. So as new people came in, I met them through my cleaning company. My mom met them through her association as an exercise instructor at the Y. So we got to meet a lot of the new people, and we were pretty well integrated. My parents had a nice residence on Hudson Street. I was situated on Washington Street. And so we were pretty stable in our apartments. And then you saw the new people come in. I mean, really nice people. I mean, I think a lot of people had concerns with the new generation coming in. But at the same time, if you met them individually, they were quite nice. I mean, you know, when people think of the whole group of them coming in and the gentrification of Hoboken, that's one thing. But when you meet them individually, it was really quite a treat. And I think me and my mom both appreciated that.
And you also, I know you graduated from Hoboken High School. Mm-hmm. What year?
Class of 81.
Class of 81. You know, as an aside, that's the year I move into Hoboken, so kind of a nice intersection there.
Yeah.
But you mentioned that you're still in contact with a lot of your friends.
Yeah, you'll see some of the pictures. But yeah, I went through the Hoboken school system. It was a 6-3-3 system then. So yeah, I went to Wallace through sixth grade, Joseph F. Brandt through ninth grade, and then Hoboken High for 10, 11, and 12. Sophomore, junior, senior.
You have a really good memory if you try.
I try.
Yeah, no, that's great. That's great. And do you think part of the strong, like many new people would say, they love being in Hoboken but close to New York.
Mm-hmm.
Do you find that the case too? Or are you just saying, I don't really need New York?
No, that's a really good question, because as you go into high school, you want to do more things in the city. Shop for back to school clothes, especially if you're a junior or senior, kind of trendy. But also we would go on different trips like ice skating, Rockefeller Center, just to the village. And as you got a little older and closer to your senior year, it depends how depends how your parents felt about New York City. So we weren't really allowed to go until we were like juniors and seniors, and you never went beyond 34th because 42nd Street was a whole other animal those days. So it was like, don't you go up there. And of course, you know, there was an allure of like King Carol records because both me and my father have large record collections. He had one. I like to collect records. So the allure was there, but you know, you pretty much behaved yourself and you stuck to what you knew, 34th Street. I think there was Sky Rink there at the time. So there were always trips in high school where you went to New York.
So you mainly went in with friends.
Almost always. Yeah.
You wouldn't go by yourself.
Not necessarily at that age. No, no, right. We were more of a group thing.
Sure. Just kind of curious.
Yeah. Somebody would start the phone chain and be like, let's go here. Let's go there. Even a couple of movies in the city.
Right. Right. So 81, still no cell phones, no social media.
No, I have to say, I kind of liked it that way. I'm still very 20th century in that regard. I'll admit that. I still, when I'm at my desk at home, I have my landline, I have a desktop computer. And if I'm paying bills or just, I'm very focused on having my desk and my creature comforts. So not big on cell phones yet, except right. To post on Instagram.
Sure. And so tell me about what, you know, you go into New York with friends, mm-hmm. but where would be your main hangouts in Hoboken?
Oh, in Hoboken? I think we talked about this briefly in the past. Burger King, that had that big neon sculpture right in the middle. And occasionally there was the diner. And when I was in junior high, there was still Gold's on Washington Street between 10th and 11th. And sometimes on Friday nights, you'd go there and they had a great meatball parmesan. I mean, they were a general diner and very of its time, like retro modern decor. It's Toasties now, but it was a great place to be. And it was a Hoboken kind of staple right there uptown.
Right. And you're like, you would call some friends and say, let's go to Gold's, or would you just know people are there?
No, we usually have a call and make a definite plan, but somebody would, I usually started the phone tree, I have to say. I would call a few friends, they get a hold of this one and that one, and then we'd all meet there.
Right.
Or we'd just meet on Washington and say, where are we going to eat tonight? Or where are we going to hang out a little bit?
And did your parents, were they from Hoboken? Or?
Yes. I believe my dad was born in New York City, but he moved here shortly after. And my mother was definitely born and raised in Hoboken. Mm-hmm. Yeah, she adored Hoboken.
Right, right. So I know a lot of people, we'll look at some pictures in a little mm-hmm. while, but I know a lot of people knew your mom through her classes at the Y.
Yes, yeah.
And would you attend some of these classes?
When I was old enough, I would say starting in the mid-80s, because she started that job in 1969, I believe. She was there wow. for over 35 years.
That's amazing.
Yeah, and it was just odd because I remember being in, I think, first or second grade. And I just remember my mom taking the job and my dad not looking too happy on Tuesdays and Thursday nights when she went up there from like 7 to 9. And later on, I asked her about it and she was like, well, you know, your father wasn't too happy about it. She goes, but, you know, she always did her own thing. She was kind of independent in that respect. So, and it wound up being a 6-day-a-week job. Soon they invited the Maxwell House crew for a noon to one class on Monday, Wednesday, Fridays. And then she did a Sunday morning class. And I just remember coming home from school, like in the third or fourth grade by now. And we got home just afternoon. She just left before 12 o'clock. But she had lunch set out for us, glass of milk, you know, and it was still cold because she had just left. So, you know, we were well taken care of. But
sure.
She was quite the independent, you know, career woman at that point with her. It was 6 hours a week, but it meant a lot to her and it meant a lot to her students.
Right. I'm sure as she walked around town, everyone, you know.
Yeah.
Would give a shout out.
Mm-hmm.
And so this was an exercise class.
Oh, yeah. It started out as calisthenics. It was never quite aerobic, but she put people through their paces. I mean, a number of people come up to me and they said, you know, as your mother got older, you know, she just kept up with that exercise pace. And, you know, she had exercises where you'd have your arms up in the air for about 10 minutes, you know, going this way and that way and up and down. And people were like, I was sweating. It hurt. She had good biceps.
Right. And how old would she have been when she, in a sense, segued out of the classes?
I think she was about 71.
Okay.
Yeah, 71 right. or 72
sure,
years old.
Sure. So it sounds like a good role model. But yes. It wasn't only seniors who did the class, right?
No. She had new people in town. Once again, she appreciated the new people in town. Couple of lifelong residents, and some names come to mind, like Liz McGinnis and Selma Strauss, and Mrs. McFeely, who I think was married to one of the former mayors. And yeah, they all kept up pretty much. You know, my mom would say, take a break if you need to. But
it was just for women?
Became co-ed. Somewhere it became co-ed. I think shortly after the Maxwell House group was invited.
Right. So and just co-ed. To explain, people might be thinking the Maxwell House...
Maxwell House Coffee Group.
Coffee Group,
yeah, right. So on their lunch break, they could start exercising.
So that's pretty interesting that the corporate entity, they would have been a big employer in town.
Oh, definitely, kinda. Yeah.
And I think they were big supporters of the Y, so maybe there was some sort of connection there with that.
And she was very lucky. I mean, she had a big enrollment. Well, she inherited the class from somebody, and they had done it for many years, and then she took over for many, many years. But the Maxwell House group, the Maxwell House Coffee Group was very receptive, and then it just kept building. Some of the afternoon classes would come to the night class, and, you know, some of the members, you know, after a while, every class was open to everybody.
Right, right. I wonder what she'd think of the Y now.
Yeah, I mean, as kids, it was a big part of our life because, you know, you all learned to swim up there. And it took me a while. My brother's a more natural swimmer than I was. He was on the swim team for Hoboken High. Took me a little bit longer. Sense of coordination didn't quite kick in.
Right.
But you swam around the middle of the pool twice, and then you could move up to the next level. There was the shallow end, the middle end, and the deep end. I don't think I ever quite made it to the deep end. But
So maybe we'll go to a couple slides.
Sure.
You know, we love that you pick so many from Washington Street and hanging out with your friends and really gave me a different impression.
Oh.
But we're starting earlier.
Yes, this is this is my baby picture. And my parents moved into their apartment at 1032 Hudson in the summer of 1963. And then I was born in November of 1963. So that apartment is the only one I've ever called home. And I still live nearby. And just as a little side note, I held that position, my mom says, for just about a second before I fell over. She's like, the photographer was there, you looked up, you put your hand there, and you fell over. But
the decisive moment, he caught it just before.
Yeah, I still make that expression once in a while.
Okay.
Yeah, but I'm lucky because I could always go home again, literally the 1032 Hudson Street.
Right, right. Cool. And do you have lots of pictures of your family? Hold on to these?
Yeah. A lot of them my brother has. And then I have later pictures, obviously, from high school. And this is, I think we were the sophomores or juniors.
So this is also Washington Street.
Yeah, this is run a city hall.
Right.
And I think it was December. So I think they were getting ready to do the Christmas tree. It may already have lights on it. I can't tell.
All right. Good observation.
Yeah.
Yep.
And I still remember most of the people in that picture.
So let's see, are you?
I'm the third one from the left.
Left. So you're doing the hand gesture.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
I thought that was you, but
just a little mischievous.
You know, still just fun to be
always
sure.
Was. Yeah.
So you would just you'd say, let's go down and.
Yeah, I think we were heading to New York that day for the ice skating.
Ah,
yeah.
Okay.
Sky Rink was a popular place. And, and there's a few popular names in there. There's Jackie Peskins right in front of me, and they came from a large family. There's Claire.
I recognize that name. Yeah.
Yeah. And then my best friend is third from the right. That's Michael Wallington. And he came from a family of like 9 siblings, too. So most people went to school with a Wallington or a Peskins, sometimes a Braxton.
Pretty
there were
cool.
A few family names you just knew in Hoboken.
Right. So this is late 70s or?
Probably 79.
Yeah.
You know, winter of 79.
Sure. Sure. And street looks pretty clean, actually. They always talk about Hoboken being a little on the dirty side, street-wise.
Maybe prior to, but this is, I think gentrification was just around the corner.
right. Yeah. Cool. The benches could still be there.
Yes, yes. They did just put them back, actually, in this day and age of COVID.
That's right.
They just put them
they
back.
They took them away for a while.
Yeah. It's
but
a good sign
who
when
knows?
You see the benches come back.
I guess so. I never thought of it that way. It's those little things that make it special.
Yeah.
But City Hall obviously is on Washington Street.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, You're right. It's definitely mm-hmm. Christmas time kind yeah. of thing. Cool. Going on to the next.
Yes. This is probably about a year later and probably spring of 80. And I think we're just getting ready to get ready for summer vacation.
Okay.
Because it was kind of a casual day there in school. I remember right. that much. And as you can see from the clock, it's almost 3 o'clock. So we were probably waiting for the bell to ring because school really was a 9 to 3 thing then. And you were very regimental, 9 to 12 lunch. And then 1 to 3, you were back.
So this is high school.
Yeah.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
And if you went into the high school hallways, mm-hmm. they probably mm-hmm. would look kind of similar.
Exactly the same.
Yeah.
I've been to a few of the
right. tiles are like red and white.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
and
well, growing up, they used to pop off the building. They were blue and white, and they used to pop off the building.
Oh, really? Okay.
So if you stood there long enough, a tile would fall on you.
Sure. So tell me a little bit about high school teachers, cliques, things you did to keep out of trouble or yes. get in trouble.
Yeah, that was a rather mixed group of us, I have to say. And we have the people I remember seeing most was Michael Wallington, whose arm is kind of sticking out there, even though it looks like Mark's arm, Anna Valenti on the upper left, and then like Anna knew Claire, and people knew other people, so the group just would grow that way. So it wasn't just, that was just our little social circle, and then you had other social circles, but they weren't really competitive. There was a lot of fluidity, and this is, I think, just after junior prom. And I mean, the one next, the young lady next to me is Monica DeBarry, and she had moved to Italy. So she didn't quite go to school with us, but except for, I think, freshman and sophomore year. But she came back, and you know, you can see we welcomed her right back. And she was great friends with Claire Vecchio in the middle.
And do you connect with these people today?
A lot of them on Facebook. There's Aracelis on the lower right. There's Natalie Shanklepore on the lower left. Michael Guzman has a successful life coaching business in Miami. So yeah, quite a few.
So Facebook is the connector.
Oh yeah. Yeah. We can always keep up with each other. And
if someone's in town, do you reach out and say, let's look for the new golds or?
Not as much as I would like. Michael, my best friend, lives in Brick now. So he comes up once in a while. So we do find things to do in Hoboken because, he likes to see the way it's changed because he spends some time up here with his husband, but otherwise they're down in Brick. But people become a little far flung. So you make some new friends and, you know.
Sure. But tell me about some teachers that you have memories of. Or
we had great teachers then. The one that pops to mind most is the history teacher, Miss Florio. She was very funny and she made American history really fun. But we all had great homeroom teachers. There was Mrs. Pescatore, our chemistry teacher. She used to call me a nudge, which she meant as a compliment, but I'm not so sure. I was a little talkative in high school, so she was like, just need to calm down a little bit. But no, teachers were really accessible and really helpful back then. They really were. I mean, teachers are still passionate, but you always have fondness for your own. I mean, your homeroom teacher. And then we just went from class to class during the day. So you didn't see the same people every class. So.
And for recess, would you go outside or let out for lunch or what's going on there?
For lunch. I would usually go home, but there was a place called Ann's Diner, which I believe was behind the high school and about a block south. And a lot of students hung out there for lunchtime. And I think also a lot of truckers and construction people. So it was quite the crowd. You were allowed to smoke then. So I think it was Ann Bufis who owned it. And she was a lovely woman. And but it was kind of like smoke filled. It had its own atmosphere, but it wasn't smoky like in the like dingy sense. It was just, you know, very busy. I mean, it took a while to get a table or a booth. It was always packed. And she was also known for meatball parmesan. So great.
And Columbus Park is right there. Would you go there?
Yes. Oh, yeah. You would hang out there. And then, of course, the football field was there. So, you know, that's a big part of Hoboken culture.
Sure.
That's the big scene.
Yeah.
And when you become a senior, you more or less help with the concession stands and things like that. The senior class club was always big on concessions for whatever social events happened at the school and then also at the football field.
Right. So these days when they talk about kids in high school or younger, mm-hmm. they talk about bullying.
Yeah.
And was, I mean, I don't even know if the term was around in the 80s, but I mean, do you remember people picking on kids or?
Yes. But back then it was just a fact of life. I hate to say that, but it was just a fact of life. You kind of just worked it out amongst yourselves. Sometimes you'd get a teacher involved, very rarely your parents, because they would say, work it out. It was just one of those things that kind of happened.
Right.
And usually we did. I mean, I don't remember anything tragic or terrible, just, you know, nuisance-y things, you know, certain people just didn't get along.
Right.
But bullying was not a big thing then. Most teachers were really concerned that your grades were good. And there was a lot of guidance in terms of which colleges you wanted to go to, because you couldn't just go online. You needed the guidance counselor. And they would help you with your college decision, your curriculums, and things like that. So they were much more oriented towards that. And you were thinking, well, where am I going to go to college? And which courses am I going to pick? And so bullying, not a big part of it. I mean, maybe other people have different stories, but that was my experience.
Right. And would you have summer jobs or?
My first job was actually at a food town on 6th and Clinton. And it was Vitali Food Town. A lot of my friends worked for McDonald's, but a few of us did work at Food Town. And I'm not sure where else people worked. I mean, you know, they might have had like a paper route. But I was at Vitali Food Town. And trying to think.
Any good stories from there?
Yeah.
Or just when it was over?
It was tough work, I have to say. I mean, McDonald's was too. But when you're young, you're just happy to be making money. And I wouldn't say that the labor practices were always fair. So I would just leave it as that. Don't want to get the historical museum sued for something I said.
Let it come.
Yeah, but when you're young and you're working, I think people take more advantage. As you get older, you get smarter your like wages and your hours and things like that.
Right.
But you're so happy to
Can
be working.
Can you remember what the hourly wage was back in the late 70s, early 80s?
Gosh, I probably have a pay stub tucked away somewhere in a box. Too.
Your memory's been so good.
I'm thinking between 5 and 7 somewhere, but maybe 5:15 rings a bell.
Yeah, I think that sounds right.
Yeah, but sometimes they would try to knock off an hour or two, and it still happens in this day and age. Sure. But when you're a kid or a teenager,
right?
You know,
and that is still a supermarket, but it's probably changed 3 or 4 names.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, it's been a Walgreens, I think, and But speaking of, just as another side note, there used to be an A&P right on Washington between 10th and 11th.
Right.
I think it had 3 aisles and the freezer section was behind you when you rung up at the register. And I think they only had 1 register, maybe a second one, but it was never open.
And so it was really small, you're saying.
Yeah, just 3 aisles. And
it was on the west side of the street?
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's it was a bank for a while, and now it's a multi-office, you know, there's an M&T bank, I think,
right
now.
I know what it, because it used to, in the old days, it was another store.
Yeah.
I remember seeing pictures.
Yeah.
Of that.
It was the Atlantic and Pacific. And they also had one on 6th Street on the south, east side of the street.
Right.
But my favorite person growing up was Dottie at the supermarket, because she would give you one of those guns with the purple ink and she'd let you stamp the top of the cans with the prices.
Those things, I can hear that sound.
Yes, that was Dottie. And there are people that stick with you for your whole life. And I'll always remember Dottie.
And Dottie was at
the A&P on between 10th and 11th.
Okay, right.
And she was a cashier, but she was also a price person. You know, you actually you hired people to actually put prices on things.
Yeah, And so Washington Street has a lot of things you mentioned are Washington Street, of course, tying that into our current exhibit at the museum.
Yes.
But you also live on Washington Street.
I do now. I live above what used to be Maxwell Tavern. And now we have a pair of restaurants that are related. So I live above the one, and they've done a wonderful job of restoring everything. I mean, they need to do everything, like replace the kitchen, but they've really upgraded our block. The restaurant that they're there now, they replaced our sidewalk. So, you know, suddenly we've gone upscale at 1039 Washington Street.
Right, right.
Yeah.
And so so when you say Maxwell's Tavern,
yes.
What time period are you talking about?
As far back as I can remember, it was Maxwell Tavern. I actually used to shovel their sidewalk for extra money. speaking of like summer jobs, winter jobs.
Would that be before it was Maxwell's Club?
I think the Nistlers had it then and the McGoverns.
Okay.
And they had it for quite a while. And growing up, you know, my parents were friends with them. You did family trips together. But back then it was just Maxwell's Tavern.
Right.
Yeah.
And many people get confused, like mm-hmm. the more recent people who've moved here, they think Maxwell, they don't know there was a Maxwell's Coffee Factory.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, they don't know what the Maxwell's Club was named after. Yes. And it gets, or they think, that's right, they think Maxwell Place, which is high-end, you know, development condo complex, they think that was named after the Maxwell's Club.
Yeah, no, it was where the Maxwell Coffee House used to be. And that really, the big wide sidewalk there really was like a second playground for us, because you were either in Elysian Park or you were playing bottle caps, because you could draw, you know, the whole bottle cap board on the sidewalk over by Maxwell's, because it was such a wide sidewalk.
Did anyone in the family ever work for Maxwell's?
Our neighbor did.
Your neighbor did.
Yeah, our neighbor, we had the Pecks, and the father worked over there.
Sure.
I think he worked the overnight shift too, because
we
were all quiet during the day as kids because we knew Mr. Peck was sleeping.
Oh, that was nice. That was nice. Cool. Okay, so we're in high school here. We'll go on to the next slide.
Just a simple picture of junior prom.
Yes.
And it's related to Hoboken because it was at the Union Club. Which had the nice restaurant, but also had the different rooms for different occasions.
Sure, sure.
So I think we had about 125 people.
Mm-hmm.
I graduated in a class of 390, which was pretty big at the time.
It's a big class.
Yeah, we were a pretty sizable class.
Right.
I think right after that, it started dwindling, but not too fast. But we were rather sizable at 391.
Sure, gotcha.
And
you're there, the gentleman with the tie.
Yes, I'm there.
And who else is
in? That's my date, Monica DeBarry, who just hates that picture because it's not an opportune moment for her. And that's my best friend, Michael Wallington, and he brought Anna Valenti.
Okay.
And I believe her family was born and raised here in Hoboken.
Yeah, I think so. Sure. A relation to... Well, Valenti is a common name. Mm-hmm. Angelo Valenti? Or that's a different branch
different
of Valentis. The family?
We also had Susan Valenti in school.
Sure, sure.
But she had a nice, lovely young sister. And I have to say, just popped into my head, we went to Sunday school together, too.
Okay. Yeah. Which church was that?
Saints Peter and Paul.
Okay, on Hudson.
If you were in public school and you were Catholic, you went to Saint Peter and Paul's every Sunday after... I think it was 9 o'clock mass.
Right. Was that in the basement or?
They actually used the school. I think when we were younger, it was in the basement. They moved us over to the school.
Right. Right.
And
right.
Once again, getting on the subject of teachers, you had some really lovely people there too.
Mm-hmm. Cool. And Union Club was the place for events in Hoboken.
Yeah, it really was.
Before the W, you know, generally your event would be at the Union Club.
Yeah.
And like you said, they had different rooms, like the gold room. And,
yeah. My cousin got married there. I was her ring bearer, so I was much younger than in this picture.
Right, right. And again, that building, the basics are there, but when it was converted for living, it sort of got... changed a bit.
Yeah, they added some floors to it.
Exactly. And, exactly.
It was a great place.
Sure.
Yeah.
One of our members is Pat Sampieri, and her father and her brother ran it for many years. Mm-hmm. And we know a little bit about it.
So if you had special occasions, that's where you went, whether it was a large gathering or just a family meal, because they did have the restaurant.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure when that went out. It's in the 80s.
Yeah.
But like after... I can remember Mayor Capiello would have had his victory celebration there after the election. And
that didn't happen.
So I think that's like 84.
Yeah.
And so it wasn't too long after.
No, I remember gentrification happening around. I moved out of Hoboken briefly in 1987.
Right.
And I remember calling my mom. I must have been in Miami for a couple of years. And she's like, there's a Godiva chocolate shop on 12th and Washington. And I said, well, that's a harbinger of gentrification,
okay,
isn't it?
Oh, Godiva.
Yeah.
Godiva. Yeah.
Yeah. I said, we've got a little upscale. And then, you know, that was the harbinger, I think. You know, it was like that was the opening bell.
Yeah. That jumped a few notches when I went to Godiva.
Yeah. I was like, yeah, that was new for Hoboken.
No, it was unusual. Yeah. You kind of go, I hope they make it.
Yeah.
Anyway. Okay. Then we're moving on with images. Yes.
Ah, that was a blustery day, obviously. And I was actually crashing with a friend at Marine View at that point. And I had moved back to Hoboken, and that's after the Miami years. And I had started my Jiffy Gym business, as you can see the little cart, and there was like all cleaning supplies and a small vacuum in there. And once again, I'd come to your house and, you know, a little Windex, a little vacuuming. And it was a great little business.
Did you enjoy it?
Very much.
Yeah.
Yeah, very much. There's nothing like being self-employed. I will say that.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, I don't think I've ever been happier in a job. I mean, I've been happy at jobs, but I was probably happiest being Jiffy Gym.
Interesting.
Yeah.
And can I ask why you stopped? Or
it's hard on the back and the knees, I have to say. It was very physical. And plus, I got a really good offer from one of my clients to start a real estate career.
Okay.
So,
So you didn't really have people working for you.
No, I did all myself. And it was always suggested that I kind of get people, but then there's insurance, and it was just more of a more personal relationship.
Sure.
With my, I want to say clients, but they were almost like family. I used to get invited to dinner a lot with people.
No, I can see you hanging out.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, oh, I got to start cleaning.
Yeah, exactly. And I used to try to wait till the end. I'm like, let me clean first.
Right.
And, but it did evolve into like house painting. Mm-hmm. So I would paint a few apartments, and I find that very zen-like. People hate to paint, but I actually do like to get into that. And then some pet sitting. So gotcha. I didn't ever have to have a pet because I had other people's. And,
you know,
so I was always visiting someone's puppy or, taking out for walks. So it encompassed a lot by the time I'd finished.
Sure. So how long does it take to clean an apartment? I guess you charge by the hour?
Usually by the job. So there was an AM job and a PM job. And yeah, so I did about 6 days a week. So I would do Saturday mornings too. So there were 11 slots, and I guess the zenith of it, I had about 36 families and individuals.
Right.
And everyone a little treasure on their own. I mean, I only remember like one or two bad apples, but most of them were long-term people who either booked weekly, monthly, or by every other week.
Right. So I always meet these people coming into the museum, mm-hmm. and then I go, I said, I just, you know, you were here the other day.
Mm-hmm.
And then they'll say, oh, I need a place to hang out while my apartment is being cleaned.
Okay.
So they would leave. That was it.
Yeah. No, it was sometimes easier if they did, because you could just get around easy and move furniture. But if they stayed, that was fun too.
Right. And then there's the person who feels they have to clean for the cleaner.
Occasionally, yeah. And I'd be like, you don't have to do that. But you didn't want to encourage it too much, because you'd come into a sink full of dishes. And I'm like, you just don't want your dishes done when you come home.
Exactly.
Yeah, you want things dusted and vacuumed and stuff like that.
Sure.
But I have very comfortable rapport with all my customers. Like I said, there were one or two that didn't quite work out. But when you're self-employed, you can say, you know, it's not working out.
Sure.
And sometimes you do a one-off. Somebody would say, I just need really a good head start. And you might give them the whole day, and they pay a little bit more. But most of it was very scheduled. And so I liked it that way.
Now you see, like, there's cleaning empires out there, right?
Yes, there's Regina Maid. And they really didn't like me. And I almost did get hit by their car once on Washington Street. And I can't really help.
Knock out the competition.
Yeah. I was like, I don't know if that was an accident or not.
Right. But I'm also amazed to see there's the cleaners, like there's a van that pulls up and then this crew comes out, you know, like in 2 seconds.
Yeah, I've seen them at commercial establishments too. The laundromat I used I think it's Wash on Willow or something. They have a whole group come in while they were open, and it was like six people would just come in like a white tornado.
Right.
But I like the personal touch that and people were very personal with me. You know, I went through people having families, having babies, and, you know, having the newborn there, new puppies. I mean, you know.
Right. And you hear stories of people really getting involved with their cleaners.
Yeah. I was into a lot of life events. You know, I was involved in them, and, you know, invited to weddings. And, you know, it was a social life and a job.
Interesting. Interesting. Okay. So we're back to our backdrop.
Yes.
And
and this was just an ordinary day in Jiffy Gym life. And I just happened to have a friend in town.
Right.
And this is in front of Richard Altamari's laundromat when he had it there. I think it's a nail salon now.
Right. But, Richie passed.
And, yeah, unfortunately. Yeah.
And ran that for many years.
Yes. Yes. And he was a very good person. And we went to high school together.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Wasn't as close as I would like to be after high school. But I think what happens is you go off to college. I think Richie went to St. Peter's. I had a gap year. And then I started in New York City at Pace. Uh-huh. Ultimately wound up at Rutgers, New Brunswick.
Okay.
But yeah, that's good old Washington Street. And I was with a friend. And I think in another picture, we'll have her with the other side of Washington Street.
Sure. Well, let's check it out. Yeah, we'll go to the next picture.
Yeah, that's my friend Mary. And we met actually at my first job in New York. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I had the gap year and I took a job at E.F. Hutton. When E.F. Hutton talks, people listen.
I remember, is E.F. Hutton around anymore?
No, they merged so many times. I think they merged themselves out of existence.
Right, but that was a real 70s, 80s marketing line they had.
Yeah, and then we met. I was 19 when I worked for E.F. Hutton, and Mary was 32, and we've been friends ever since then. Her fiance lived in that building at the time, so she was in Hoboken visiting, and... yeah, I was working, so she probably went to see Pruitt, and I went off and did my cleaning thing. And that's the 800 block of Washington Street.
Right.
Both, and that was just both an ordinary day. Yeah.
East and west.
Yeah.
So thinking of 80s and thinking of 2021, mm-hmm. what are the biggest changes?
Oh, gosh, there's so many. I know I've heard from somebody the other day, the high school's on the upswing again, which is nice. Practically everything, the face of Washington Street's changed. And that was, now we have AT&T stores, Verizon. So, I mean, we didn't have the cell phones back then. Washington Street mostly had actually merchandise. You know, they weren't services so much as you had merchandise, you know, back to school clothing. I remember some of the bargain stores. There was B&D Bargain Town. There was C&B's, and they sold household stuff. But a lot of knickknacks, too. You don't see too many knickknack stores anymore. And I'm kind of like a tchotchke king at home.
Do you remember Al's Bargain Store?
I do.
That was a good one.
And then there was Mickey Finn's on the south side of town, a little bit towards the west.
Right.
I'd only been there once, but I know a lot of my school friends.
People their parents loved Mickey Finn's.
And they called it Michelle Finney.
A dollar went a long way.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah, they called it Michelle Finney. It's just like you had Target, but yeah.
Oh, I'd never heard that.
I was only in Mickey Finn's once, and then they didn't meet the happiest of endings there. I think there was a fire. But I remember it being another great place for back to school things you needed, and if you needed it inexpensive. Because I think people were on a budget back then. It was the 70s and 80s where, we're kind of in a recession and stuff.
Sure.
But in terms of Washington Street, I think the most that's changed for everybody is the technology now. You have cell phone stores. So they're all services, restaurants and services. But you used to be able to really shop on Washington Street. And if you go back even further, like my mom would remember in the 50s, all the dress shops, ice cream parlors. And just as an aside again, because it just pops in my head, my mom said if you were in an ice cream parlor, you would have all the kids outside with the strollers lined up. Usually prams, those big, metal wheels. And she said if a baby was crying and another mom went by, she would just pick up the baby, it would stop crying, you'd put it back in, and all the moms would watch outside. She had like seven or eight moms, and you'd have the mom outside, helping with your kids. And you couldn't do that now on Washington Street.
You'd be arrested for kidnapping.
So that's one of the bigger differences on Washington Street.
Right, sure.
But yeah, now we're more service-oriented. And I liked growing up in the 70s and 80s because I'm still very 20th century in that regard. Mm-hmm. I like person-to-person contact. I think Jiffy Jim ties into that really well. But people are a little more anonymous now. But back then, you met people on Washington Street that you knew. You know, other people from other families. Like you'd meet, I knew Michael, but I also, Michael Wallington, my best friend. But you'd see his mom on Washington Street or one of his brothers and sisters. And you always knew somebody from like high school or something.
So are you saying you don't really connect with people you know on Washington Street as much now?
I would have to say that's true. During the Jiffy Jim years, yes. And that took off rather organically because I got word of mouth. I had an ad once, just one time in the Hoboken Reporter. And I think I picked up three or four clients and then they referred me to three or four more. So I don't think that would happen necessarily as organically as it did for me in 1996.
Right.
Yeah, I just don't think people look up enough anymore. They're just into the phones. And yeah, on Washington Street, everybody looked up, so you'd recognize each other and you would talk to each other.
Right. So less of that, you're saying.
Yeah, definitely less than that.
Sure. And like now, so many families have whatever term you want to use, caretakers or nannies for the kids.
Yeah.
I sense there wasn't as much as that.
No. I mean, basically, when you went out, like if you were in grammar school or you hung out with your friends on your block, you know, your block was your world. And like I was lucky enough to live by Elysian Park, so you could go across the street and you were out most of the day, like especially on summer vacation, you were out most of the day. And then somebody would stick their head out the window, usually your mom, and, you know, be like, Jim or Tom, my brother. And then other mothers, too, would call their kids. And, you know, if you didn't come home in about 5 minutes, you know, you knew you were going to get, you know, a stern talking to. But
sure.
But we all knew each other from the neighborhood. You didn't venture too far from your neighborhood. And then, you know, that's what you had grammar school and junior high for, you know, especially grammar school.
And what about summers? Would you go away?
My family is bigger on staycations.
But, staycation.
Yeah, day trips too.
Day trips.
Yeah, my dad used to take us once a year on the Day Line, which was it was about an 8-hour cruise around Manhattan. No, actually up the Hudson River. The Circle Line went around Manhattan. We did that too. But the Day Line would take you up to Bear Mountain and West Point, and you always got vanilla custard ice cream cones while on there. And it was just a good day out. So when my dad was on vacation for a week and we were on summer vacation, we would go on day trips.
And staycation means?
We didn't really travel that much. My dad traveled a lot through the war years and for business after the war. My mom was not a traveler. She always wanted to go on a cruise, she said. But people would say, well, don't you want to go on a vacation? And she'd like, well, you just wind up back in Hoboken. And she really was like enamored with Hoboken in that way. And I used to try to explain to her, when you go on vacation, it's about the journey. But she just was very happy in her world in Hoboken. She would be happy to hear about your vacation. I like to hear about people's vacations. But she never had a strong desire to travel. And I think, once again, that speaks to Hoboken, where she was just very happy here.
Huh.
And she would venture to New York City a lot.
You know.
She was a shopper over there.
Would she go with friends or?
Often by herself, sometimes with me. Sometimes she'd invite somebody from the Y who was a new student or something.
Mm-hmm.
And then she had a steady stable of friends that she'd call up once in a while and go, I'm going. Do you want to come along?
Right.
But sometimes she wanted to be a loner, and she was an only child. So sometimes she wanted to be alone. Other times she'd invite friends.
And would she tell you stories about growing up in Hoboken?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, she mostly liked the fact that there were dress shops on Hoboken. She would talk about raising kids in Hoboken. Our whole family was from Hoboken, like her grandmother. And then, of course, growing up, she grew up on Hudson between 11th and 12th. And you had blended families then. So she lived with my parents lived with her parents. So my grandparents, my maternal grandparents, they lived with them for a while. And then you got set up and they moved over to Park Avenue.
But stayed in Hoboken.
Yeah. Right. She just loved it here. But mostly she'll talk about, like, you know, growing up with her girlfriends in high school. And, of course, they really kept in touch because a lot of them stayed in Hoboken. I know there was the Flusks that lived across town. My mother's best friend was Winnie Flusk. And you don't hear that name much anymore.
Yeah.
Sure. And we had our neighbors, the Kellys. So sometimes all the families would go out together, like barbecue somewhere.
And that would be the old high school, Demarest, right?
Yeah, I'm trying. Yes,
because your high school would be like 62.
Yeah. And she used to talk about the snackies. That used to be a big hangout for them.
Can you elaborate on that?
Well, they used to have lunch in the back when the booze were there. But
and the official name was
Schnackenbergs. Yeah, Helen and Dora had Schnackenbergs, and even I remember Helen and Dora. I mean, they were like a fixture in Hoboken for many, many years, and lovely women. But my mom said they used to try to have like sock hops, which were like school, you know, school dances, except it was after school. And Helen Dore didn't quite go for that. So they put the velvet rope. That's where the velvet rope actually came from. I didn't know that, but they roped off the back and they were like, there'll be no dancing back there. But dancing was a big part of her life growing up. She said, you know, you grew up basically with a group of guys and a group of girls and you'd socialize. And they all kind of paired off and married off. And, my dad had to kind of wear down my mom's resistance a little bit because, once again, he had the record collection that I mentioned, and he would bring his record collection and a little, you know, a little stack of records and his record player. And he would, I guess, for lack of a better term, hit on my mom or, you know, try to nuzzle up to her. And she wasn't always that receptive. And she'd be like, take your records and go home, John. So
her personal, she's dissing her personal DJ.
Yes. And then he would actually, and, you know, but eventually they did marry and, you know, I guess something worked out along
the way. So what music?
It's a lot of what I grew up listening to, too. It's funny. Big band music. My father was a big Glenn Miller fan, so I listened to a lot of Glenn Miller. I remember they used to have these records from Plaza House, which were like the 30s remembered, the 40s remembered. And Plaza House was a record label. You actually ordered the records through the mail. You saw them on TV, you dialed the number, and they got delivered to your house. And usually you sent a check-in or they came in COD. So we're going way back. And but I listened to a lot of those records. So you heard things like Les Paul and Mary Ford. Nat King Cole. So that certainly informs my passion for music. And I don't play anything, but I do enjoy different genres of music.
Sure.
And once again, you pick these things up from home.
Right. A lot of people come into the museum and they're trying to connect with Frank Sinatra
music.
And I, you know, I always make the comment that it's not the music of that person's generation.
Yeah.
And invariably it went back to their father, grandfather, or whatever.
Yeah, your parents definitely inform your different cultural choices.
Sure. Interesting.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. We have a few more pictures, perhaps.
Okay. Uh-huh. Yeah, and this is my grandmother's apartment. She was in her mid-80s at this point. And she lived in what was the Yellow Flats, which is now what we call applied housing. So she had a cute little one-bedroom apartment up there. And
just a stone's throw from here. Really,
yeah, exactly.
Right?
Just around the corner. And she was a block away from 1032 Hudson. Like I said, you don't really move too far away from Hoboken. And if you do, like I did, you always come back. So I think it's ironic that, you know, I moved to Florida, I moved to New Brunswick, and then I wound up a block away from where I grew up. And my mother helped find my apartment because she saw C. Fallon showing an apartment in what was above Maxwell Tavern. And she's like, you should look at that apartment. Because I was looking. I was actively looking. And I called Steve Fallon, who owned the building. He introduced me to Alice Gallman and Maureen Singleton, who everybody knows from town. And I went to school with Maureen's daughter, Jill. So I called them up and they showed me the apartment and I loved it and my mother hated it because there was just a little tear in the linoleum in the kitchen. There was no refrigerator. And Steve's like, I will furnish you a refrigerator. And she grew to love that apartment. And I have to say, her back window kitchen looked into my kitchen window. And I always say a pulled down shade really keeps a family happy.
There you go.
Every once in a while, I'd open it and wave and they'd be like, hello.
Actually wave to your mom from
yes,
your apartment.
Yeah,
that's great.
Yeah. Yeah, and I would see her through the fire escape, and once again, as a little aside, I remember my mom climbing out onto the fire escape. So that's how you hung out your laundry when we were in the 60s and 70s. You had a clothesline.
Sure. So she had a clothesline.
Oh yeah, we had a clothesline growing up.
And, yeah.
Yeah, but this is my grandmother's apartment, and she had that till about 1996.
Uh huh. And that's your brother?
That's my brother Jack, and he's a bartender at the Wilton House.
Wow.
Has been for many years.
Right. Right.
And I believe
one of the few bars that really hasn't changed, I don't think.
Yeah, no, the Wilton House is pretty. Yeah, I know. I was introduced to his bosses there, and they're nice people. But he's worked days there for many, many years.
Right, right off of Court Street and Newark.
Yeah.
I wonder when that got started. I have no idea.
Yeah, I'm not really sure.
Right. And I recognize your mom.
Yes.
I can sort of hear her voice. She's very energetic, right?
She was, yes. Yeah. And she had to be to keep those arms up for the exercise. And, you know, yeah, she kept that up for an hour.
Man.
She rarely broke a sweat, but we were all dying in class.
Right. Cool.
Yeah.
And moving on,
that's
another crew.
It had to be somebody's birthday, and it was probably my mom's, but we celebrate almost every birthday up there.
Everyone has cake.
Yeah, and then that's why you needed to exercise, basically, is because we were always eating cake. But it was a good class. I mean, once again, there were men there, too. But most prominently, Joe Martin. He was a former Marine. He was always in the back of the class and very protective of everybody. And by this point, I was probably making mixtapes and mixed CDs to exercise, too. That's what got me into the class.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
You provided the music.
So yeah.
You'd bring a boom box over,
yeah,
or it would,
yeah,
be cassette, or
it would be cassettes in the beginning.
Cassettes,
yeah, right. A boom box and a cassette. Later on, they did get a stereo put in and
right,
the CDs.
Right.
But, yeah.
And this is in the Y, this picture.
Yeah.
I can sort of see the floor scuffed up.
Yeah, so we were probably upstairs.
Yeah. They did a lot of things in that building, right?
Oh,
there,
yeah,
a lot of different, yeah, classes.
Yeah, you could have a school club there if you have enough members. They'd let you, mm-hmm, use one of the conference rooms.
Yeah, the museum used to use it for talks, mm-hmm, before we had this space.
Yeah.
And it worked out fine.
Yeah. I can't wait to see if they actually revive it in some way. It
was, right.
Yeah. Because they had quite the swimming pool. And
yep,
a couple of years ago, they did a story on that they were getting ready.
Just takes money.
Yeah. Yes.
That's okay.
Yeah, my mom was popular with the residents because she always made cakes for Thanksgiving and Christmas,
uh-huh,
and brought them up.
Right, right.
And that's Jane Zeth, and we're really good friends. And I actually met her through somebody at the Y. Well, it was her ex-husband. I don't think she'd mind me saying that. But
so Jane knew your mom.
Phil, her ex-husband Phil Leonard, came to the class, and
okay,
then they needed somebody to clean, and then. Jane usually worked late, so one day she was home early, and I met Jane. I was actually in their apartment playing with her two cats, and she came in, and yeah, we've been fast friends. And once again, I think this is a picture of interest, because not only is she one of my best friends, but everything's changed on Washington Street again. You have a...
Yeah.
Yeah, you have...
Even the parking meters.
Yes, yes, yes.
It's like the vintage parking, mm-hmm, meters.
Yeah. I think you have Planet Fitness there now. You have a doctor's office where Hudson United was, and PSE&G is somewhere to the left.
Right.
I'm not sure what Fleet Bank is.
Yeah. And then what, Havens is a little further up.
Yeah.
Right. So that's the only thing that's the same, probably,
yeah,
in terms of businesses. Yeah. Whew. That little Washington Street.
And then Jane took this picture. When she turned the camera around, there's Swift Photo. And we had Swift Photo and People's Photo on Washington Street. And
right,
we talked about this briefly once a while ago, that if you took your film to People's, you had a way of just cropping your pictures a little bit, or, you know, you didn't have filters then like you do on Instagram, but he would crop your picture just in a way that it made it, you were a slightly better photographer. He would make you look like a slightly better photographer.
There must have been some button you pushed that,
yeah,
said move.
Yeah, but he was a very nice man, yeah.
Dave Marsh.
Yeah.
Dave Marsh.
Yeah, he was a very nice person. Quite quiet. But like I said, he'd make you look like an expert photographer. And then the Swift people were very nice. I think after People's left, that's where I started going.
Right.
And Swift, actually,
I can't remember that family. It was a husband, yeah, and wife.
Yeah.
And they were so nice.
Yeah, they were very nice too. You got your pictures back exactly the way you sent them. But that was fine too. They did great work.
Right.
And I also went to physical therapy there after they became the physical therapy office.
Mm-hmm.
So,
which is, I think, their son.
Oh, is it? Oh, I, yeah, didn't know that.
Yeah, so, ask him, yeah, if you go in there.
Yeah, it's always a small world. You might,
right,
have been in one store in one incarnation.
I think they own the building, so,
yeah,
they kind of,
yeah,
made sure, yeah, their son could,
yeah,
set up.
So on
there.
I think it was a video store next door.
I think so.
Just popped into my head, but
yeah, which one?
Yeah,
yeah.
There's a chance that, you know, if you've been in one store in Washington Street, you've gone into another incarnation later on.
Sure. Well, we talk about the Washington Street game,
yes,
and you try to remember what was,
yes,
that different places.
Yeah. I think the biggest stores we had growing up were Crest and C&H Martin's, and then Crest became Macquarie's, and C&H Martin's. I don't remember what they were in between, but they're currently. It's a food market. It was Garden of Eden.
Oh, and now Basic,
yeah,
Foods? Or
no,
no,
that used to be a Rite Aid.
That's right. You'd be good at that. Well,
yeah.
We should have you on for that game.
Could be a, yeah, board game.
Yeah, we've talked about doing,
yeah,
one, but we don't get to it.
Yeah.
Okay.
But,
might be getting sort of to the end. I don't know.
Yeah, I think so. That,
yeah.
Oh, oh,
what a shot.
Yes. That's my mom in front of the yellow flats and just before she got married.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, no, she, like, as you could tell, she used to talk about the dress stores, but she was a really good dresser.
Right.
And I could tell you a funny story if we had time about the Fox stole.
Please do. We have time.
Fox stole somehow wound up in my grandmother's closet for many, many, many years.
We're talking about her
accoutrement,
the
furs, exactly,
which was very common,
yeah,
in the maybe 40s and 50s?
Yeah, yeah, which is all right. Yeah, this might be the earliest it might have been is 49, but no later than 51,
okay,
1951.
Right.
And it was in my grandmother's closet for many, many years until she passed in 1996. And we were cleaning out her closet. and my brother Thomas was in the closet, and he was looking for something on the floor, and the little fox head fell off, and he thought it was a mouse, and of course he hit his head on everything that was in the closet, and it just, little fox head just came rolling out.
Well, those things would, they're like pelts, yeah. And yes. They'd be sewn together.
Yeah, exactly.
And invariably, yeah. They would get very hard.
The fox head had the clip that yeah. would clip it around.
Oh, they were just horrible.
They yeah. kind of were. I mean, when we saw it, it was like, and you actually wore that.
Right, yeah. Exactly. I'm not quite sure how yeah. people thought it as yeah. an attractive adornment.
No,
but it, yeah. And she got yeah. a little flower on her hat.
Yeah.
I
yeah.
think.
Yeah, hats were big then.
So yeah, she had, purses yeah. are so classic. Yeah.
And the little wave in the front.
Nice dresser. Yeah, cool. Yeah.
And that's her, and probably at the height of her Y career.
Yes.
And that was done by a nice reporter named Josie Zaman.
I remember Josie.
She yeah. had a column called Just Josie, and it mostly focused on seniors, if I'm not mistaken.
I think you're right.
But she did yeah. a nice profile on my mom, and they sent a photographer, and they got a pretty good shot.
I think it was Jersey Journal.
Yeah, just New Jersey Journal.
Yeah.
And she always had, my mom always did have t-shirts with clever little expressions or cute little pictures.
Right.
And she would say, as the picture says, look as if you're enjoying yourself. And but like I said, she didn't really break a sweat, but we did. And that's the kind of exercise. You'd have your arms up in the air for 10 minutes and you'd, go forward, rotate them forward and then back, and you'd push them up and down. And after about 5 minutes, it was like, is she ever going to stop torturing us?
But right. But she's so joyful yeah. there. And she kind of looks like she's levitating.
Oh, yeah. She had great arms. And
yeah.
And she wanted you to have great arms, too.
So did she have other jobs, or was this the job?
Before she got married, it's funny you should mention that, because we hadn't talked about this at all, but she worked for the Royal Liverpool Insurance Company in New York.
Okay.
And her boss's name, I always remember, was Lester Terwilliger. And I just thought, you couldn't make up a name like that. And my mom always said she was a lousy secretary, because she would take dictation. She'd write it down the best she could remember. And when she gave the finished letter that she typed to Mr. Terwilliger, he's like, did I really say that? She's like, well, I thought it sounded better that way. And that was kind of my mom, always a little diplomatic. And, yeah, she was a true diplomat, but she had her ways of, like, I thought it sounded better that way.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So like the people's photo guy making better
pictures.
Yes,
exactly. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. She never really said anything negative, and, she would always put a positive spin on things.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Yeah. And I would say she is a big influence on your life.
Very much. Yeah. We were very close. And I get a lot of my disposition from her. And I think our Hoboken outlook is about the same, too.
Sure.
And, my mom was a lot of fun, and she touched a lot of people's lives.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's why I enjoyed the Jiffy Gym thing. It was like one of the segments that we had in common, that we just like meeting people, new people, and things like that. And there's always something going on in Hoboken.
Right.
Where you have the opportunity to get to know people.
Because
just to put a finer point on that, like, we still have the Hoboken parade around Halloween. And you get around, you meet the new people. And that's part of old Hoboken, but now it's a new Hoboken tradition. So, I mean, it kind of marries the two really nicely.
Sure. I think when newcomers to Hoboken meet you, they probably, they have a good diplomat to sort
my mom
connect them.
My mom definitely knew how to bridge that gap.
Mm-hmm.
So
you're following that tradition a bit.
Hoping to.
I think so. Very sweet.
Yeah, met a lot of nice people at that class.
Mm-hmm.
So some of them I still keep in touch with.
Right.
Some of them are very active in Hoboken yet.
And so you live on Washington Street.
Yes.
You have a lot of strong connections. Mm-hmm. So you live in the old Maxwell's Tavern.
Yes.
And there's a new business there.
Yeah, it's a nice new restaurant. They really made the block look very pretty. And and I have to say, just as an aside again, my brother lived in the apartment above mine in a totally different time and place.
Really?
Yeah, he was there in the 70s with his first wife. And then they moved to a different place. And then who knew years later I'd wind up on the second floor, the third floor. They lived on the top. And even growing up, we had a connection with that building, because we had Mrs. Chuse on the ground level. Her son was Eddie. He was active in politics many years.
City administrator.
Yeah, if I looked out the window, I would say, hello, Mrs. Chuse. And she'd like, Jimmy, very heavy Italian accent. But that was the neighborly thing in Hoboken in the 70s. You could yell across the courtyard
right
over the clothesline.
Sure. I have this image of you sending a message to your mom on the clothesline. I don't know if that could have happened.
Just the usual just yelling the across. Usual
yeah, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, usually a wave. But
right.
But in earlier Hoboken, you'd yell across the court.
You would yell.
Yeah, whoever your neighbors were.
Sure.
Hey.
That's right.
But it was always, hello, Mrs. Choose.
That's right.
Yeah, because I have a really big connection with 6311 Street, sometimes known as 1039 Washington. So,
So things are okay with the new business there?
Yeah, it's very nice having them there.
Yeah.
And we have the streetery now, so it's nice to go out and, you know, see the people dining.
It's life.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Good. Yeah, but they definitely made our block look pretty and everything. Mm-hmm. So and it's a welcome addition. We miss Maxwell's.
Right.
Because we had Dave Post and everybody down there, and they had great music. And I remember Bruce Springsteen filming his video there for Glory Days.
Sure.
But, you know, the changing face of Hoboken.
Right.
So it's nice to see the new people out there in the streetery.
Well, I could see certain people saying, oh, Maxwell's is so much cooler, and now I got this, you know.
It kind of was. I can't diminish that fact, you know.
But you're wanting to look at it in a positive way.
Yeah.
And that kind of sums up your personality from what I've seen, that you could be grumpy, but you kind of know things change,
yes.
and you can't really change the change.
Yeah.
And so might as well accept it.
Yeah. And I know a lot of people miss Maxwell's. I do, because it was very a lively crowd, but it was their choice to retire, I think, from Maxwell. They weren't forced out in any way. So it's easier when people aren't forced out, but they ran it really well. And like I said, it was always a lively place, sometimes a little too lively at 3 a.m. But when you live above a restaurant, you kind of know that's your thing. And I'm a sound sleeper, so that's a good thing too.
Yeah, sure.
Should be in the lease. Right. Can sleep soundly through anything.
Gotcha. Okay. Anything else you want to bring up as we segue out? But it was great learning about your mom, and I love this idea of the epicenter of, you know, this address that you live at, and your mom just being like 150 feet away.
Yes.
And,
like I said, a clothes blind makes a happy family.
Definitely. She would say the same thing.
Right? I think so.
Yeah, definitely. Long and sure in agreement.
Yeah. But no, definitely Hoboken's been a great experience. Like I said, I wound up back here and pretty pleased to be here.
And doesn't seem like you're really looking for another place.
No, I love that apartment. I mean, it's a railroad flat. In case anybody doesn't know, they just go straight through all your
forever.
Rooms. Yeah. And my parents grew up pretty much in a railroad flat.
Right.
So one big family, one bathroom, that can be a problem. But now it's just me and I have my own bathroom, and you don't have to deal with that so much.
If the shoe fits, wear it.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. I think a lot of us grew up that way. Just, a small apartment.
Right.
Very compact.
Sure. Okay. So. Thank you very much.
Oh, thanks. It was a lot of fun.
We're going to do a little segue and a few thank yous.
Sure.
We've been speaking with Jim Link, and this is an archive show, so you're watching it that way. It's been great to have Jim on board here today. I had a great time. I learned a lot. We'll mention that we have some upcoming shows that should be of interest. I believe it's next week, a week from the Thursday that this will be shown on, is Glenn Marr will be talking with Danny Schott. Danny Schott has been a guest, and I believe this will be his first time he's interviewing. And Glenn is very well connected to the music world with Barnarn Records and also Maxwell's. And then after that, we'll be having Jack Silbert, who's also been a guest and has hosted. And he'll be interviewing Karen Listener, who's with Patch.com these days. But most of us knew her for her many, many years with the Hudson Reporter. And very connected to Hoboken still. So I do want to thank Rand Hoppe, who's been our engineer for the show and keeps us on track with good audio and good video. And he engineers all the programs. And then a special thank you to some of our supporters, Donald Shackett, who has loved Hoboken very much and really thought about when he was planning his estate to think kindly towards the museum. And we're so thankful to him. And then ongoing support, of course, from the New Jersey Historical Commission, which gave us a grant to upgrade our equipment for these programs. And then we also thank Applied Development Company every day for their big donation of the space that we call the Hoboken Historical Museum. And we are celebrating our 20th anniversary here. And I don't know how quickly, I can't tell you how 20 years has gone by so fast.
Happy anniversary.
Thank you. And so thanks again for checking out Hoboken Talks, which is weekly. So check us out and signing off. Again, a reminder that Hoboken Talks is just one of the many programs that the museum does. I guess I would say our main program is our exhibits in our exhibit space here in the museum. And currently, you can watch, not watch, you can experience the Avenue, A History of Washington Street, which we refer to a lot in this program with Jim tonight. And that's on view now. The website is hobokenmuseum.org. You can check us out. And then we also, in the upper gallery, we have the artwork of Don O'Grady, which will be on view until, let me see if I get this right, September 12th. Okay, so a little time left on her show. And she's done a great job interpreting Hoboken in a realistic way. Mm-hmm. And the upper gallery gives some of the best art shows that you'll see around town.
This is true.
And this is truly signing out. Have a good evening. And we've had a great time here tonight. Thank you again, Jim.